Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. It's Sunday morning, January 15th, 2023. As you notice, we have a guest minister, which actually, I don't want to say guest minister, it's sort of part of the ferns in a way. We have Reverend Felicia Hoyle here again, and this time coming to my husband, Reverend Bill Hoyle, now retired from Clarence, so he's able to accompany his spouse on her trips around the state. Anyway, any information, if you don't want more information about Felicia, is on page 4, and I guess you know already know that all the information is there. Announcements on page 6 of the bulletin. The only actually added announcement is the I put the flower sign-up sheet for 2023, which is in the notice board in the church lobby. So if you want to go over there after the service and decide on a particular date for any family member in memory or in honor of, just go ahead and do that. Upcoming events. Next Saturday, the session have their monthly session and planning meeting for the year. So any points you'd like to bring out to the session, approach one of the elders or send us an email about what you'd like to discuss in that meeting. And then next Sunday we have a congregational meeting after the service with regards to the to Travis's remunerations regarding 2023. Then on Tuesday, January 31st, we have a new thing here where local musicians will be performing in the fellowship hall Tuesday evening starting at 6 o'clock. So we have local musicians coming out there and treat you with local music, banjo, guitars, etc., whatever they bring. I don't bring anything, so I don't worry about it. I've got problems with singing already. Then on Sunday, February the 5th, already advertised, we have a dinner and showing of the Sight and Sound Theatre production of Esther. This is 5 o'clock with a meal and 6 o'clock with the show on that Sunday, February the 5th. That's all from my side here. So we're singing now and then we take it over from there. Okay. Welcome again.
The choir is coming out. What we will be doing is a piece that Joyce Collins always love to do for very special occasions. We are singing For the Lord Is Our Light, and it is a Zulu song, Siyaha.
father died last week, the funeral was this afternoon, so that's why I'm here today, and I appreciate being here. So we come first to the installation of elders. We're doing this first so that Wilson can get to be here right now. So notice first, let's be aware that Deborah Alford is completing her term. Is Deborah here? And the elders elect that are being installed today are Mary Mabum, I said right, and Wilson. Where is Wilson? Wilson is back there. Could the two of you come down here, please? Would you mind? Oh, I've skipped the call to worship. Because I'm Sunday. Okay. Yeah. Okay, stay where you are. Thank you, Bert. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay, let's join first in the call to worship. And what I also intended to do was point out to you a scripture that we're reading several scriptures today, but one that I left off that is sort of important. It's I'm reading from Psalm 40 and just the first few verses of it. It begins, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. A new song that fits with what our choir was singing. So please join me in the call to worship. We are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Grace of God has been given to us in Christ Jesus.
And we are rich in Him, in speech and knowledge of every kind. We are not lacking in any gift as we wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ.
So let us sing a new song, a song of thanks and praise, for God has done wondrous deeds and is great beyond compare.
Now we serve. God works through each person in a unique way, but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. To each is given a gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together, we are the body of Christ, and individually, members of it. Mary and Wilson have already been ordained to this special way of serving as being an elder, so we will not be ordaining today, but simply installing them. So I have constitutional questions for you. Mary and Wilson, in baptism you were claimed by the love of God, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. Now you're called by God through the voice of the church for a different kind of service and ministry in Jesus' name. In accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA, show your commitment to this calling by responding to these questions. You trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, acknowledge Him Lord of all and head of the church, and through Him believe one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Do you?
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old Testament and New Testaments to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you?
I do.
You sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do, and will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you?
I do.
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
I do.
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's Spirit and will? Will you? Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you?
I do.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you?
I will.
And then, will you be a faithful, ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church and in your ministry? Will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
And then, questions to the congregation. You'll see that they are printed there. Do we, the members of the church, accept Mary and Wilson as elders chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Do we agree to encourage them to respect their decisions and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
Amen.
And then I do have a prayer. May we pray. Gracious God, with joy we give you thanks and praise. Throughout the ages and in every place, you have chosen servants from among your people to point the way to salvation by your grace. We are grateful for ancestors of the faith who followed without fear, placing their trust in you alone. For judges and monarchs who ruled in righteousness and peace. For prophets and apostles who spoke your bold words of mercy and of truth. For leaders and teachers in every age, who have nurtured your people in faith and faithfulness. Above all, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life to set others free. Anointed by your Holy Spirit, he proclaimed your reign on earth, revealing your saving love in all he said and did. Gracious God, we also give you thanks for your servants, Mary and Wilson, that they, as they continue in ministry to which you have called them, helping them to rely on the gifts of your Spirit and to follow Christ faithfully in this calling. Give them the spirit of truthfulness, that they may show the compassion of Christ in the actions of daily living and rightly governing your people. By the gifts of your Holy Spirit, empower them to help build this church, to strengthen the common life of your people, and to lead with compassion and vision. In the walk of faith and for the work of ministry, give all your servants gladness and strength, discipline and hope, humor, humility, and courage, and an abiding sense of your presence. Gracious God, pour out your spirit of power and truth upon the whole church, that we may be for you a holy people, baptized to serve you in the world. Sustain your church in ministry, ground us in the gospel, secure our hope in Christ, strengthen our service to the outcast, and increase our love for one another. Show us the transforming power of your grace in our life together, that we may be effective servants of the gospel, offering a compelling witness in the world to the good news of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. So you are now installed for service and ministry and governance in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Thanks be to God. Thank you. To God, for the Holy One is steadfast in love and always ready to forgive. And as we come into God's presence, we are surely aware of our own shortcomings. So let us pray aloud together. It's printed as we make our confessions. Mothering God, we have forgiven us as we spent our strength on vanity. Our labor has been in vain. Deliver us from arrogance. Thank you. you sent your Son to be the light of the world, so that all may know the brightness of your love. Fill us with your grace this day, so that we too may bear witness to this light and serve your coming reign. O God of steadfast love, you raise us up when we fall and you place our feet on steady ground. Strengthen us by your faithfulness as we offer our prayers in thanksgiving for the grace that is ours in Christ. O God, we pray for the mission of your church, that we may proclaim the good news of the age as we put our trust in you. We pray this especially on this day as we are installing new elders. We pray for the session as it guides this congregation. O God, we pray for the world, that your saving love may reach the ends of the earth. We pray for all who suffer, that we may heed their cry as we share in your mercy. O God, we pray for your creation, that we may safeguard its well-being. O God, we pray for those who are suffering from the effects of storms, temperature, rain. We pray that you will be with them. O God, we remember before you those who have died. We pray especially for Travis and his family from the death of his mother. O God, today on this eve of the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday, we thank you for his life and his ministry, for the way that he helped to show the injustice in the world and to help lead us toward peace. God, we pray that our eyes will continue to be opened and our hearts to the racial inequalities in the world, and that we will see each other and see ourselves. O God, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours forever and ever. We are your children, and we pray aloud together the prayer that you taught when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Join me in the use of prayer for illumination as spring in your bulletin. Come, Holy Spirit, Heavenly God, as you send your Son to be the light of the world, open our eyes to the brightness and illumine our hearts and ears to the truth of your word. And the testimony of Christ among the strength of the moment and the glad news of the deliverance revealed. First reading today is from the book of Isaiah, which you can find in your pew Bible on page 830 in the Old Testament. Isaiah 49, verse 1 through 7. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he built me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he led me away. And he said to me, You are my servant Israel, in whom I will be glorified. Then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with my God. And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the sight of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant. To raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel, I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, and his Holy One, to one is deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, slave of rulers. Kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you.
Thank you.
the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes. To the church of God that is incarnate, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into partnership of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And then our gospel lesson today is from John 1, 29 through 42. This is John the Baptist, John the Baptizer speaking. He says, "The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, 'Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I have said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel.' And John testified, 'I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, "Him, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look! Here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. All this is the word of God. Thanks be to God. So I'm happy to be here with you in this season of Epiphany, when we're reminded over and over about the coming of God in flesh as a human being. You may remember from last week when I believe that Bert was reading the sermon that Travis had prepared. It probably had to do with Jesus' baptism, so you may wonder why we're doing that again. Repeating this ties into the whole history of this season. Choosing to read from the Gospel of John isn't surprising in this season, since his gospel provides us with some of the most direct display of both the incarnation and the epiphany. Remember that it's John 1:14 that says, "And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory." The word glory, or glorified, was used in that Isaiah passage that Bert read. Like epiphany itself, it refers to light. Light, glory. I wonder if you all have any Greek neighbors around. celebration of Christmas all get squashed together in Epiphany, especially in the Greek church. And it's actually a good thing. You see, incarnation needs more than just the birth to make the point. God becoming flesh is a big deal. The incarnation, God in the flesh, is complicated. It's a mind-boggling idea. So let's stay with it for a little while, as we do during this season called Epiphany, or the season after Epiphany. In Jesus' baptism, God claims him, claims Jesus as his child. This is none other than the Son of God. And John goes on to testify the next day, as it is said here in the scripture. Here he is, the Lamb of God. And then in John, we have this beautiful little story of the calling of the first disciples. You see them creeping along, looking through the hedges, it seems like. What are you looking for? Jesus says, come and see. There's a naming, and there's a call to action, but I'm getting ahead of myself. So let me tell you a story. I've probably already told it here once or twice, but it fits today, especially with the installation of elders, and it especially fits that my husband Bill is sitting here, because for years he has given sermon illustrations that involved me. So now I'm going to give one that involves him. So he's just retired, as Bert was saying, as the pastor of Clemens Presbyterian Church. We've been married 38 years this coming July. And at our wedding ceremony, early in the service, as part that's traditionally called the betrothal, the pastor had just asked me, Felicia, will you have this man to be your husband, to live with him and honor him and cherish him and hold the bond of marriage? And I answered, I will, as prescribed. And then Bill was asked the question, will you have Felicia to be your wife, to live with her, etc., in the holy bond of marriage? Now, captured on the video and forever in my memory was his answer, loud and clear, with the help of God, I will. So, it was also captured on that video that there was a big snap of my head. I think that my bell kind of flew around. And that look on my face, it's still there. You can see it on the video. It was like, say what? His answer, of course, was appropriate. As we have relied on God's help many times in the commitment that is marriage. And it was later that I learned that with the help of God I will was part of the installation and ordination and church membership and even baptism vows as stated in the Presbyterian order, though the answers were no longer spelled out. So the folks today did not say with the help of God I will. It was just that early on there, as a woman just starting out, it seemed a little harsh that he said, with the help of God, I will. So it's probably also a good thing that our installation was before the service, or you would have been distracted by whether they were going to say, with the help of God, I will. So as we read in the gospel lesson today, Jesus has been born, the wise men have come and gone, they fled to Egypt and returned, the innocents have been slaughtered, and then here he is, a grown man. Even if we had the story of Anna and Simeon rejoicing when the infant Jesus was brought to the temple, and the story of the boy Jesus being left behind there, it would seem to be quite a leap. Interestingly, in the Gospel of Mark, John, all that other stuff has been left out. And this is where the whole story begins, with Jesus and with the baptism. It's indeed a momentous beginning, like a marriage ceremony. John says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not It's real. It's not just a dream. It's flesh and blood. And it's as real as those promises and those vows that I told you about. So let's look at that passage from Isaiah, which Bert read. You probably read a lot of Isaiah in the time leading up to Christmas. And when we read these words, it seems pretty easy sometimes to just go ahead and interpret that it applies to Jesus. The words, I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach the end of the earth. But there's also some historical context here. In the time that the words were first written, the people were looking for a word of hope from the one who had brought them out of Egypt and had established a covenant with them. They were in crisis. They were ready to be saved. So, who is this word from Isaiah? Who is it to? Who is it from? Who is it about? The answer is yes. Everyone. It fits as a word to us now. The servant has been prepared by God for nothing less than to bring the glory of God into view everywhere, all the time. I think it's pretty clear. The person speaking hears God say that salvation isn't just for the tribes of Jacob. The words in that scripture says, that's too little a thing. But salvation will reach the end of the earth. This Isaiah passage has been called one of the servant songs. And surely this is a song that God sings to each of us. That all of our work, no matter how local, must have the good of the whole world as its aim. And we are all called to shine with God's light to all the world. In the season of Epiphany, we all can see that all of our lives are in the light of the glory of God. And it's a work for all of us, not just your elders installed today and the other ones serving. God has been given as a light to the nations, and we are all called to shine that light. So our answer to that call should be, with the help of God, I will. Think about it. With the help of God, I will. What do you think would have happened if Bill's answer to that marriage question had been, with the help of God, I'll try? I don't think there would have been just a snap of the head in that answer. I will has a commitment to something that's real. It's not just a leaning or an inclination towards something. I will is the answer that's required of God's call. And now for the heart of the matter, the word from John. You remember that Sesame Street song, one of these things is not like the other? Well, Sesame Street really captured it. John is the one that's not like the other. It's the one gospel that's just very much. I've already mentioned how John and Mark begin with the tale of Jesus' life, beginning with baptism rather than birth. But John is even more different than that, beginning with this whole light and darkness thing and tackling directly from the start the awesomeness of Jesus incarnate. Of Jesus as God incarnate. We have to remember that not only is Jesus God in the flesh, a human, Jesus is also God, divine, both human and divine. And that really is something I think that is beyond our comprehension. We have enough trouble as human beings understanding what it means to be human. We really know nothing about what it means to be divine. Here we are trying to understand all of it. Thank goodness for Epiphany to shed some light on it all. Epiphany, God manifest. God manifest as a human being. Incarnation. The writer David Toole has said that we need this string of Sundays with Jesus being baptized, walking into the Jordan, and the clouds parting, and hearing God's God name Jesus as his son. And then we need to see two men peeking around the corner, trying to find out where he lives. And to hear for ourselves, Jesus ask, "What are you looking for?" And then, come and see. That's a call. That's a call. Come and see. Move. Look. Use your own body and your mind and your curiosity, your eyes. Do. Not, I'll try, but I will. See for yourself this gift that has come to you, the light for all to see. We are called to live in the light, to act, to be, to live, to ourselves point to and be the light. Like Teresa of Avila's poem, Christ has no body now on earth but yours, no hands but yours, no feet but yours. Yours are the eyes with which Christ looks out in his compassion to the world. You are the feet with which he is to go about doing good. Yours are the hands with which he is to bless the people now. All that's important and true. But I recently heard some good news. I've been my busy self, and it's been a whirlwind with Bill's retirement and holidays, and I was doing way too much, and I was feeling busyness and stress. And then I read this story that Roger Nishioka, who is a Presbyterian pastor and leader, he told this story. He said, it was in a time like that, and a friend had made an urgent request to meet him for lunch. And the friend said that she was going to share some really good news with him. And so Roger, perplexed, said, I asked her what the good news was. And she smiled and said, I want you to know that the Messiah has come. And Roger continued, now I was thoroughly confused. So she told me she had even better news for me. You are not him. The real danger in distorted incarnational theology is that we come to believe that if we truly are Christ's body in the world, then if the world is going to be saved, we have to do it. The Messiah has come, but you are not him. Jesus was given as light to the nations. We are called to point to that light and light, let that light shine. Jesus says, come and see. so are we. The message we hear, and in turn say,